It's nice to see all of you here this Sabbath evening. I'm afraid in many places in the United States they no longer do this, and I always thought it was such a nice way to come together as a family on Sabbath evening. Those of you who heard me this morning, you realize that I was a refugee. Now, for a lot of people, that's hard to imagine. And I've always been proud of the fact that I learned four languages before I was 10 years old. And then today, on the way out, I met a young lady who said she'd learned six languages before she was 10. And in the United States, it's not customary to learn many languages. In Europe, there's a great deal. But it's interesting how English has become the unifying language almost around the world. When in my early times of training overseas and trying to help was post-Soviet Union breakup. And as I've mentioned to some of you, a bit jokingly, don't ever ask an Estonian if he or she speaks Russian. Because even if they do, they don't admit it. They don't want to. It goes back to 50 years of horrible repression, cruelty. So no, I don't speak Russian. So I was in Ukraine, and it was just 1 year after freedom. They put me in this hotel that had obviously been beautiful at one time. You know, a curved staircase and chandelier, but very shabby, very poor condition. And I was with a colleague who was a Russian teacher, an American who was a Russian teacher. But I couldn't even go out by myself because I didn't even know the alphabet. So I couldn't memorize the names of the streets unless I thought of every street that I was walking on. It was an interesting experience. Then I went back there and worked there maybe 10 years later. And they had changed the alphabet, so at least I could get around. It was a very interesting experience. Well, I was a refugee from Estonia. We had wandered homeless through Germany, got to Scandinavia, and finally the General Conference, the Adventist, helped us a great deal. And I've always thought what a blessing it is, and I hope that I can help as much as people helped me as a child. When we got to the United States, I've always been a curious person, so obviously I've been a curious child. So I enjoy nature. And behind the apartments that they had for the seminary, in those days they were in Tacoma Park, near where the General Conference building was. So I used to go down into the woods, exploring, and I got acquainted with a uniquely American plant. I don't know if you have anything like that here, although I did encounter such a plant when I was doing some work in Thailand one time, and I was on the grounds of a Buddhist temple with some friends, and I saw this tree with little berries. And so I took a berry and accidentally squeezed it, and it came out of its skin and bounced off my arm. And the person I was with said, and dashed me to where there was some water and ran water over my arm. And I had an instant red rash that then became big white welts. So you do have some plants like that. But in the United States, we have a plant called poison ivy. Do you have anything like that here? Poison ivy. You touch it and you break out. You get little bubbles on your skin, you get red, it's very ugly, it's itchy, it's painful. Well, my father had been sponsored to go to the seminary, and it happened that I had gotten into poison ivy all over. And when his graduation came, they wouldn't let me go to his graduation, so I must have looked terrible. And I still have this distinct memory of sitting, it was a very sparse apartment. You know, we had nothing, and it was a furnished apartment. And I distinctly remember, now my parents, because they had lost everything, they wouldn't let me out of their sight. So I must have really looked terrible for them not to let me go to my father's graduation. But I remember sitting on the couch, I was 9 years old, and they had given me a Bible comic book. I still have these vivid memories. And the comic book was on the book of Esther. Wonderful story. It has so many elements of good literature, but also so many interesting themes. Well, I knew that eventually we wanted to get our citizenship. And I also was old enough to realize that when you got American citizenship, you could do what you wanted to with your name. Now, I knew that my parents would never let me change my first name, and that wasn't an issue, but I didn't have a middle name. And so I decided right then that I was going to be an Esther. We went to South America for 5 years. I hung on to the idea I was going to be an Esther. I hung on to my comic book. We came back. We had to stay in America for another year to reestablish residency. And then we went to the immigration. I have a big heart for people today because even in those days when we were immigrants who were welcomed, it was a frightening experience. I was 13 years old by then. So we finally came to the time when they said, okay, what are we going to do with your name? And somebody decided that instead of spelling my name L-I-L-J-A, because of the problem with the J in the English, in my language, it was a ya sound. In English, it's to ja. So they said, okay, it'll be easier for Americans to spell your name L-I-L-J-A. And then they looked at the papers and they said, and by this time I was scared to death. They looked at the papers and they said, it looks like you don't have a middle name. Do you want a middle name? And I was so rattled, I said, Ruth. So I'm Lilya Ruth, at the time was Binglis Wagner. Well, so much for the Esther, except that many, many years later when I took this job, some people looked at me and said, you're an Esther. You're here at the right time. So I finally got to be an Esther. But I have always appreciated the book of Esther, and I'd like to talk a little bit about some of the meanings in the book of Esther, and what does it mean for us today? There are some unique aspects about the book of Esther that we will look at. But first of all, it's also a very dramatic story. If you take a look here at the outline of the book, remember, Esther was just a simple Jewish girl, but she must have been quite beautiful, because when the king was looking for yet one more new wife, she was selected out of the whole group. Now, for us today, this is a little bit horrifying, but remember, having a harem back then was very common. And in a way, that gave her privilege, but she did not abuse the privilege. And then she becomes aware of a plot. First of all, she had hidden the fact that she was Jewish. And this was actually her uncle's suggestion. Her uncle was her parent. And the uncle had said, you can do much good for us if you are in the court, but do not reveal that you are Jewish. So then she overhears this enemy of her people. Think of the moral decisions that she had to make. What do I do now? And she loved her uncle, and she knew he would be in danger too. So they take action. And I've always found this very interesting because as I travel all over, Food is a very important thing. Food is hospitality. Food is more than just nutrition. Food is hospitality. It's a way to welcome you. It's how we talk about things while we're eating that's important. Remember Psalm 23. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. It's a way to bring people together. So Esther has this brilliant idea that she is going to invite this high-up individual to have dinner with her and the king. And of course, Haman, being the proud individual that he was, he really felt honored to be invited to this dinner. Then what happens? She was smart. And by now, she had won the confidence of the king. Remember that if you approach the king without being invited, without being announced, and if you came up to the throne and the king did not put his scepter out to you, you would probably be killed immediately. So she was brave. And on behalf of her people, she approached the king. And he extended the scepter. Well, you know how the story turned out. Mordecai is honored. Haman is executed. The Jewish people are rescued. There's a feast that they celebrate until today. One of my best friends is Orthodox Jewish, and it's very interesting to see how today the Jewish people still celebrate some of those Old Testament events. Well, as we look at Esther, I think one of the really key factors to remember is that one statement that Mordecai made to Esther. Maybe you've come to the kingdom for such a time as this. What about us? Are we here? Do you work at the hospital, perhaps, for such a time as this? I don't know if it's the end of time or not. I know that the world has great needs, needs that we can fill. Are we come for such a time as this? Let's take a look at a few of the characteristics of Esther. She used so many of the traits that we can learn from. These aren't great terms, or these aren't something unusual, but Esther took what she had in character, in experience, in knowledge, in wisdom, and I'm quite sure that she was a godly individual, that she never forgot the teachings that her uncle, her beloved uncle, had taught her. So first of all, Esther had courage. It takes courage to stand up for what you believe, to stand up for those people who look to you. I was quite recently in some of the former Eastern European countries. Some of them, like Romania, Albania, if you know your geography, they were under the thumb of the Soviets. They weren't exactly part of the Soviet Union. Many of them were part of the Soviet bloc. And it was very interesting to me, as I was working with many, many pastors, they came, about 60 of them came together for training. And as I was driven around that beautiful country, one of the people who was my driver started telling me what it was like, because they knew my background, what it was like during the Soviet times. I know how it was in Estonia. It was hard to know whom you could trust. Somebody sitting next to you might have been coerced, threatened, or bribed to be a spy for the Soviets. And he told me with great sadness that there were actually pastors who didn't have the courage to stand up for what they believed. They became part of the government's secret network, and many others were killed. I don't know what I would do. I would hope that I would have the courage that Esther did, to have the courage of your convictions, to do the right thing. Sometimes it's a very simple thing, as maybe not telling a lie, but maybe misrepresenting something. I think we all have to question ourselves, what would we do? Would we have the kind of courage that Esther did? Secondly, I appreciate loyalty. I appreciate when my staff are loyal to the mission of the organization. I very much appreciate it if they're loyal to me. Our loyalty to our families. I have returned back in 1992 to my homeland, found all my relatives. Now, there were just four of us, my older brother and my parents, when we had to escape because my father had the unique position of being an Adventist leader. And I proved to him that he did the right thing when he escaped, that he would have definitely been killed. But it was so interesting. People who had never met me, they had never seen me because I was a baby when we escaped and we were in a different part of the country, little country though it was. The loyalty that people had to this stranger from America, but she's one of us. And it was the most beautiful thing to see that kind of loyalty that my relatives had to someone who basically was a stranger, me. And we're very close, that kind of loyalty. But that loyalty even extends to your organization, to your church, to your community, to your country. The loyalty, when I think about some of the people I know who had been in prison camps during the Vietnam War, what they went through to retain their loyalty to their country, the United States, brutal conditions, but that loyalty. Do we have that kind of loyalty to our God and our church family? Now here's an interesting thing, the ability to adapt. This actually goes along with what I've been talking about all week with the staff. We take good principles of what works in fundraising, then we adapt them to the culture here, to the country, and to the particular organization. Adaptability within a framework of what we know is right and good. I have to adapt all the time, but one of the interesting things of adaptability that sometimes it's a very simple thing. Dr. Toe, would you mind coming up here so I can illustrate something? Now, in my country, in Estonia, people are very reserved. Yeah, there we go. They call their friends by their last names. How are you, Dr. Toe? And now this, my father, very intelligent, very good leader and all that, he goes from this culture to the Latin American culture. What happens there? Ay, ¿cómo estás, señor? And my father goes, what just happened? Thank you. Adaptability. Adaptability for good purposes. It's an enjoyment for me to go to different places. Sometimes I even have to think about what kind of food is there. Some eat with chopsticks, which is nothing for you, but for me it's a bit of a challenge. Adaptability can be enjoyable for ourselves, but also very productive for our environment. How do we adapt to changing conditions? And I think there's little that changes as much as healthcare. New advances, new ways of doing things. In America, new government relations, government restrictions. And of course, if you watch the news at all right now with the change in government, big trouble over Obamacare, which really is the Affordable Act care. Adaptability makes our lives richer, but also that of people around us. Earning respect. As I already mentioned, Esther had to have lived in such a way with her relationship with the king, and she was not the only wife, that he respected her enough that when she came up to plead on behalf of her people, he gave the scepter and accepted her. Earning the respect makes us much more powerful in doing good. Self-confidence You know, self-confidence even expresses itself in our body language. What about our eye contact? Now, I know some of this is very cultural, but how do we talk? How do we deliver the message of what we are able to do for others? Having the self-confidence. I like to think about what Jesus must have been like. He was delivering a message that was not popular with the leadership. What made them actually fear him? The self-confidence that he was the Son of God and he was here to deliver a message to God's people. So we have a lot that we can learn from the book of Esther. This is a unique book in the Bible. First of all, the Old Testament book, it shows God's work and plan without direct contact with God. You think about all the other books of the Old Testament. God speaks. God is a presence there. This is a book that the actions are guided with reference to God. It's a unique book in that sense. And in many ways, it's really a book to which we can relate better because we don't have God physically here, but we are God's people. And then it has definite historical and factual roots. You can go into the historical study of that time of the country called Persia. And even today, some of my friends from Iran call themselves Persians. It's an interesting way to talk about it. And you can go back to the kings of Persia, to the kingdoms. And this is a true story. And it teaches the characteristics of God's people: faithful, humble, wise. Humble and wise are not contradictory. Some of the best people that I've met, people who are perhaps ambassadors from their countries. When I was working on my previous job, I did a lot with embassies, ambassadors. I've met presidents of other countries. The greatest people are those who are not stuck on themselves. They are appropriately humble because they care about what their service is. And that certainly was the case of Esther. Obedient, generous, and of course, because of the work that I do, you know I would pick up on the term generous. So when we think about Esther, one more thing to think about is that Esther was generous. Esther didn't think of just herself, and think about how many times she could have. First of all, she was honored because she came into the king's court. Secondly, she was honored because Mordecai said, "You're in the right place to do something." And people sometimes conjecture, how old was she? She could have been even a teenager at that time. We don't know for sure. But given how things worked back then, she could have been a teenager. Think about the courage it took in her teens. So she was generous with her influence, her wealth, her loyalty to her people, but also the loyalty to the king. Sometimes we think, can you serve two masters? If you do it right, like Esther, you can, without compromising. She was blessed by giving of herself and her means. That brings me to the final thought, using Esther as such a beautiful example. Generosity. As I've been speaking to different groups, one of the things that I tell groups is, even today, even in the United States, we have jokes about fundraising. In fact, I sometimes say, when I'm traveling, and somebody sits down next to me, and we make eye contact, and we begin to talk. And when strangers meet, the first thing that they talk about is the weather. Your weather is beautiful since I come from winter. Although our winter has been pretty warm, your weather is very interesting because in my little country, to get the same kind of effect as your climate, you build a little room, you put a fire in the room, you throw water over the fire, and then you sit there enjoying the steam. That's called a sauna. Well, you live with it. So this kind of conversation that we have when we first meet. Now, the second thing that people talk about when they make eye contact and they talk to each other. See, she's smiling appropriately. When they talk to each other, the second thing they talk about is, what do you do? Okay, she looks friendly and nice, so I want to keep the conversation going. So I say, I'm a teacher or a trainer. In particular, since she's young, that'll impress you, won't it? Thank you. She said, yes. Or I might say, I work for nonprofit organizations, and for many people, that's a mystery. You mean you can't make a profit? Why do you exist? So I explained that. But if at this point, no matter how nice she is, I decide that I really have a lot of work to do. I have my laptop, I have papers I need to look at. So I don't want to talk anymore. So when she says, what do you do? I enthusiastically say, I'm a fundraiser. And that guarantees she's not going to talk to me anymore. But folks, let's think about coming back to the book of Esther, but also the context of Esther. The Bible. The Bible is full of good advice on how to use our money. The blessings when we share our money. You go back to the Gospels, which directly talk about what Jesus did and talked about on this earth. Many of those relate to money. Many of those relate to the use or the misuse of money. But my favorite one is the Bible text that says, it's more blessed to give than to receive. When I first went to work with Indiana University, there was a person who had written a book called Give to Live. Now, this was 25 years ago. And people said, well, that's a nice idea, but we don't really know if it's true. It just sounds nice. Well, since that time, I have collected research from secular, high-level organizations, and the conclusion is that people who are generous, they live longer, they're healthier, and they're happier. And certainly that was a story of Esther, wasn't it? She was generous in every way. And from all records that we can find, historical records, and of course, the ending of this story in the Bible. She lived to see those benefits. So when we help people be generous, we're actually acting the way the Bible suggests, requires. Esther's generosity in so many ways is an example for us. And I hope that all of us, in one way or another, as we sit here at the close of the Sabbath and we think about the life of Esther, the example, I hope that every one of us, regardless of our age, regardless of our work, can say, I've come here for such a time as this. May God bless you as you consider your role.